morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Lovely to see you all. Welcome to Upper Trosland Baptist Church and to those who are watching on YouTube. Our preacher today is Reverend Richard Harrison. It's lovely to have you here with us, and we continue to pray for you and the family. We're looking forward to hearing what God's word has to say to us later on, but we're going to just have a few notices now once we get them up on the screen. But just while we're waiting for that, just to let, I did send some text messages yesterday, but I didn't get a chance to tell everybody that our dear sister Marion Webb has passed away. So some of you will remember the two Marions from Goitre and Sarum who used to come, and they would come sometimes in the morning because Sarum only meet in the afternoons. And then Marion Williams passed away during the lockdown, and Marion Webb eventually was in a residential home in Abergavenny, and her son Michael rang Richard the other day to say she'd passed away. And her funeral is going to be in Sarum and Goitre, and Pastor Richard is going to lead that funeral, and I'll let anyone know the date as soon as I have it confirmed. And of course, we continue to pray for the Wag family and the Norman family and the loss of Derek. And as soon as we have details of Derek's funeral, we will let you all know. So we have had a time of people being promoted to glory, quite a number. And so though we are sad, we do not grieve without hope. And we continue to pray for all of those who are grieving loved ones. So let's pray, and then I'll give these notices. Father God, thank you so much for bringing us together. Thank you for a beautiful sunny day. And though the weatherman tells us that there are clouds and storms on the way, we trust you. And it reminds us that through all seasons of life, you are faithful. And we just give you thanks for the sun that we have now. And we praise you for it and trust you in the rain. And Father God, we just pray your blessing on Richard as he preaches today. Be with him, speak through him, and bless us all with your holy word. Accept our prayers, our praises, and our gifts as we bring them to you today. And be glorified, we ask, in all we do, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
So, some notices, as you see there, we've got Richard Harrison this morning, and then this afternoon, we have got Hope Explored Part 2. Please pray for Hope Explored. It's a small number, but we had a really blessed time last week, and we're totally trusting that the technology will not give us any trouble this week. And we're just really looking forward to looking into the area of peace today. So that's in the hall at 4 o'clock. Oh, don't forget tea and coffee, obviously, in the hall after this morning service. We have a busy, busy week ahead of us. So please do pray. If you're not involved in any of these events, obviously you're all welcome, but please pray. It's a very busy week in the life of the church, which we are grateful for. So Monday, we have got a service in Regency at, does that say 11? Sorry, my eyes. 11 o'clock, a service in Regency. Anybody who wants to go to that can meet here for a lift, I think at about 20 to 11. And then at 2 o'clock, we've got open house in the church hall. Then Tuesday is an all-day affair. We've got the CAP prayer meeting on Tuesday morning in the hall at 9:30. Then we've got the soup and Welsh conversation. This is part of Churches United in Pontypool are organising this as part of Christian Aid Week. So any donations we receive towards the soup, we will be giving to, as part of our collection, to Christian Aid. And Celia is going to facilitate some very, very basic Welsh conversation. So even if you don't know anything and you'd love to try, it'll literally be, hello, how are you? What's your name? Where do you live? That type of stuff. But it'll be really nice if you'd like to join us for that on Tuesday. And then the ladies who come to that can stay, because sisterhood will be happening at 2:30. And then in the evening at 7 p.m. is men's fellowship. All men welcome to our men's fellowship. So on Wednesday, we have the Pentecost Praise in the Market. So that's an interchurch thing organised by the chaplaincy. And anyone who's free to come to the market for 10:30 to sing God's praises as a witness in the market, please do come and join us there. And then our Bible study and prayer meeting this week is an evening one, 10 to 7 for a cuppa and a 7 o'clock start. Then on Saturday, we've got tea time at Trosland. So please do sign up on the sheet in the hall if you're going to come to that. And then next Sunday, we're back here. Pastor Richard is preaching in the morning, and then it's the final installment of Hope Explored. So again, please do pray for Hope Explored. And just a special notice, we're going to have a service of thanksgiving for Doreen Harrison. We thought, as the funeral couldn't happen here because our space wasn't big enough, wouldn't it be nice as a church family for us to gather together, and maybe some of those who weren't able to go to the funeral to come, and we will give thanks for Doreen and all our memories of her and her life. So that's happening Saturday the 25th of May here, and then we'll just have tea and some nice cake in the hall afterwards and share some fellowship. So we would love you to come to that. Pop that in your diary, Saturday the 25th of May. Are we any more? That's it. Okay, great stuff. We are going to stand and sing a couple of songs. First of all my ways are known to you. This is one of our new ones, so we're repeating it this week so that we get it, just get familiar with it. And then after that, we're going to continue with Praise the Lord, His mercy is more stronger than darkness new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Let's stand and sing together.
In days of peace and days of rest, in times of loss and loneliness, the rich or poor, the word is true, that all my ways are known to you. The fire has come beyond your hand, the step I know beyond.
they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you truly love me more than these? Yes, Lord, he said. You know that I love you, Jesus said. Feed my lambs. Again, Jesus said, Simon, son of John, do you truly love me? He answered, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus said, take care of my sheep. The third time he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, do you love me? He said, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. And Jesus said, feed my sheep. I tell you the truth. When you were younger, you dressed yourself and went where you wanted. But when you're old, you'll stretch out your hands and someone else will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go. Jesus said this to indicate the kind of death by which Peter would glorify God. Then he said to him, follow me. Peter turned and saw that the disciple whom Jesus loved was following them. This was the one who had leaned back against Jesus at the supper and had said, Lord, who is going to betray you? And when Peter saw him, he asked, Lord, what about him? Jesus answered, if I want him to remain alive until I return, what's that to you? You must follow me. Let us pray. Dear Father in heaven, we thank you for the account of that meeting with the disciples, most of the disciples, and Jesus on the beach of the Sea of Galilee all those years ago, and the conversation that took place. And if Jesus were in our midst, as he is by his Spirit this morning, I wonder if he said to each of us, do you love me? What would be our answer? Dear Heavenly Father, grant that there'll be a genuine move in our hearts towards you afresh this morning. Seal the relationship we have with you, Lord, with an anointing of your Spirit upon this hour of worship. May it be a glad hour, an hour when we are lifted up into the canopy of heaven itself, because we ask this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
We're going to read again from Acts chapter 1, because Acts chapter 1 actually covers the period we're in now. Remember, Easter, especially the Passover, which was used, if you remember, by Jesus to introduce his teaching concerning his death and resurrection. And this is recounted in the Acts particularly, and there was a whole 50 days from the Passover to Pentecost, which is next Sunday. And during these 50 days, a few things happened, and we'll read a little bit about it now. Acts chapter 1. In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach until the day he was taken up to heaven. After giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen, after his suffering, he showed himself to these men and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. So when they met together, they asked him, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? And he said to them, it's not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. After he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. "Men of Galilee," they said, "why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you've seen him go into heaven." Then they returned to Jerusalem from the hill called the Mount of Olives, a Sabbath day's walk from the city. And when they arrived, they went upstairs to the room where they were staying. Those present were Peter, John, James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James son of Alphaeus and Simon the Zealot, and Judas son of James. They all joined together constantly in prayer, along with the women and the Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brothers. In those days, Peter stood up among the believers, a group numbering about 120, and said, "Brothers, the scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit spoke long ago through the mouth of David concerning Judas, who served as guide for those who arrested Jesus. He was one of our number and shared in this ministry. With the reward he got for his wickedness, Judas bought a field. There he fell headlong. His body burst open and all his intestines spilled out. Everyone in Jerusalem heard about this, so they called that field, in their language, Akeldama, that is, field of blood. For St. Peter, it is written in the book of Psalms, 'May his place be deserted, and let there be no one to dwell in it, and may another take his place of leadership.' Therefore, it's necessary to choose one of the men who have been with us the whole time the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from John's baptism to the time when Jesus was taken up from us. For one of these must become a witness with us of his resurrection." So they proposed two men, Joseph called Barsabbas, also known as Justus, and Matthias. Then they prayed, "Lord, you know everyone's heart. Show us which of these two you have chosen to take over this apostolic ministry, which Judas left to go where he belongs." Then they cast lots, and the lot fell to Matthias. So he was added to the 11 apostles. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for the wonderful scripture that tells us what really happened. We thank you that this is a trustworthy record, and we pray that we might be able to apply it to our situation today. We do praise you, Lord, for the scriptures, and as we now sing your praises, be with us for the rest of this service, for Jesus' sake. Amen. Now let's sing together, "Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine."
Divine.
Gracious God and Father, we do thank you that the dawn chorus generally across the world wakens people up as the birds sing together at this time of year. What a glorious world you've made. Yes. How beautiful it is. Yes. Lord, we sometimes get photographs, but the real thing is so sweet. And even the crackle of thunder also adds to the drama of your creation. Yes. And we thank you, Lord, that you've caused us all to be able to make watertight homes, but we think and pause this morning to realize that in two parts of the world, especially in the Ukraine and Israel, there's great fighting going on. The times are tempestuous, and Lord, we know that there are people who have no homes to go to, and they're afraid of walking down the street. Lord, have mercy upon them all. Now, Lord, we pray for our political leaders. We do ask that you will guide them, our own Prime Minister. We pray, Lord, that you will elevate people of character to lead our nation. Please have mercy upon us. Let there be young men and women who will dedicate themselves to you and be unafraid of standing for truth and righteousness in all aspects of national life and across the nations. Lord, we pray for the peace of Jerusalem. We ask, Lord, that you will be gracious to all who live there and bring an end as soon, Lord, as in your sight you need this to happen, because we know that people only have their day because you allow it to be so. And we pray, Lord, for your help. And we ask you, as we think of the coming again of Jesus into this world, we've just read that after he went up into heaven, the angel said to the onlookers that he would come in the same way. And I pray, Lord, that that day will come soon. We do pray, Lord, for the fulfillment of Scripture. We do ask, Lord, that the church will come into her own and stand for you whatever happens. Lord, it's one thing to sing here. We pray that we may take the message wherever we go. May Jesus, you rule in our hearts. We pray this morning for those who are not well. We think especially of Greta, who has lost her partner of many years. Bless her today, and Janice and Helen and the next generation and the next after that. Bless them, Lord, we pray today. We pray for Marion Webb's family. We pray for Jan Roberts' family from Llandegfeth Road. Lord, bless Gordon Cook as he takes the funeral shortly for her. And now, Lord, we pray for those who are mourning the loss of loved ones. We pray that you'll support them, each one of them. And for those, Lord, who are troubled, not knowing maybe how to make ends meet, please will you bless Christians Against Poverty and other activities that have been brought into being to seek to meet the needs of people around them. So we pray, Lord, for our doctors and nurses, for Anne-Marie as she waits for an operation to have a new cornea inserted into her eye. Lord, please sustain her through the waiting period. Bless her husband, Lord, who is preaching this morning elsewhere and again this evening. Please will you, Lord, bless him and their influence in this church and in this community. Father, bless all our families. We pray for our children. Lord, many of us went to Sunday school. Maybe we didn't even have much choice about it, but we went. And we had a basis for living given to us. Now, Lord, please do the same for a new generation. Oh, God, bring people under the sound of the gospel.
Yes.
Because we know how transforming this message is. To think that all our sins can be forgiven, that we can be fitted for heaven. Lord, we need you. May your power be manifest even in this service. Glorify your name through the Spirit's work in our hearts today. Fulfill all your purposes and forgive us, Lord, for the times when we fail you and turn away from you. Just like Peter did, he denied that he even knew you, and yet you restored him wonderfully to a ministry. And we ask you to help us fulfill your purposes for our own individual lives, as well as for the purposes for this church. Lord, bless this church and its influence throughout the area where we live. And to you be all the praise and the glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory for ever and ever. Amen. We're going to sing now the next hymn. And during the, we'll remain seated for the first two verses. I think there are two verses. Love Divine. And stand up for last, but we'll have the offering during the course of the hymn. Thank you. Love Divine.
Oh,
Represent a tithe, an offering, a love offering. Use them for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
When Jesus left this earth, he prepared his people, the disciples, for a waiting period. It's not easy to wait, actually, for lots of things. The mind plays all kinds of tricks, thinking, you know, what is it going to be like? Some of you are waiting for an operation or various things. Even the dentist can be a bit daunting. So just let's remember that the Lord knew what he was doing when he told the disciples to go to Galilee after he'd risen from the dead. And in Galilee, which is where most of them had been born and brought up, this, if you remember, Peter was known by his dialect, just as I'm probably known by my dialect when I feel a bit tired. But you understand that we go back to our sources, our roots. And Jesus took the disciples back to their roots in order to have a serious talk with them. Now remember, every single one of them had run away when the heat was up. Yes. And they weren't around when he needed them the most, you might say. So, and please note how gently he did it all. When he took them to task, he didn't say to them, whatever were you doing? He understood the frailty of us humans, because he was human. He was tempted in all points like we are, and yet without sin. So it's possible, when you think about it, if Jesus could do that, you say, well, of course, he's in a class all of his own. Well, don't minimize the humanity. He was truly human. And I do believe the temptations that he went through were real temptations. But he was in touch with his Heavenly Father. And it specifically states in the Bible that Jesus wanted always to do what his Father wanted him to do, and he never did anything on his own. He always had this in mind, and he therefore was able to say to his disciples, just as I have heard what my Father is saying and I've tried to follow that, you must now hear what I'm saying and follow what I'm now doing. I want you to have the same kind of relationship with me as I have with my Father. Now, that's only possible because of the indwelling Spirit. Now, the Spirit had not yet been given because Jesus had not yet been glorified. Now, when Jesus was glorified in heaven, he sent the Spirit to the waiting disciples, 120 of them, in the upper room in Jerusalem. And in that place, they were all gathered, including his brothers, please note. Did you know he had brothers? I'm sure you did. He had at least four, and sisters. We don't know how many sisters he had, but it's quite an amazing thing. They would be there in the upper room amongst the 120. And in that, which we'll celebrate next week, it was the descent of the Spirit to live within our hearts that's made all the difference. If Jesus were in person on this earth, we'd have a struggle to get to see him. But because God the Creator has so ordained that they go to, that Jesus goes back to heaven, but his Spirit descends into the hearts of people. So that people have said, our hearts have been strangely warmed. I can say that. Yes. Some of you can say it. All of you need to be able to say it, that you have a burning heart. Because that's what Christ does within us by his Spirit. And therefore we're never alone. That's the amazing thing. Nor are we under condemnation, because a holy God resides within us. We're not condemned because of that. We're glorified in our own little way, one day to be fully. And eye has not seen, nor ear heard, neither has it entered into the heart of man the things that God has prepared for those who love him. There's a lot to come, a tremendous lot to come. And I'm looking forward to it, but I want to take as many with me as I possibly can. I believe that he's only delaying so that, like Noah of old, when he was locking up the boat and going off for a sail before this deluge came down, he wanted as many as possible to come in. He brought all the animals in that they were decreed, you remember? And I do believe he wants before the judgment of God upon a wicked earth. The earth is all right. The climate gets a bit difficult at times, but of course God knows all about these things, and he wants us to enjoy his largesse and don't live like paupers. People are afraid to talk about holiness. This is the character of God. We shouldn't be ashamed of being holy. It's not to do with us, after all. It's all because of his great love to us. He doesn't want us to walk alone. He wants us to enjoy his company. And he taught the people this in the 40 days before the ascension. Jesus made it his business to reassure these people in different ways. So, for example, on the very day that he rose from the dead, Mary Magdalene, out of whom he'd cast seven demons, was the first to see him in his risen form. Isn't it kind of Jesus to go to a woman who was so seriously possessed and then set free, that he should go to a woman like that to be the very first to see his and recognize him in his risen form? Yes. I think that's so wonderful. Yes. And you see, two people were walking to Emmaus, yes, the same evening, and they were not sure about what had happened. They were, and a stranger came and joined them, and they said to him, Do you not know what's happened in Jerusalem? And Jesus didn't at that point tell them who he was. They didn't recognize him. But he gave them a marvelous Bible study. I would love to have been there. Just how all the scriptures spoke of Jesus. And then you see, when they got to a house, and the house where they were living, and they said, come in and have a meal with us. As he brought bread and they had a meal, they immediately recognized him. And they said, did not our hearts burn within us whilst he walked with us and talked with us by the way? And this is Jesus. And he wanted them to realize that the experience that they were going to have in their hearts was a fulfillment of the scriptures, so that the author of the scripture is God himself. He has inspired the word of God. That's why when a new convert comes to Jesus, the Bible becomes a living book to them, because it's the Spirit who has come into their hearts to illuminate what they're reading in the scripture. And if you want to be a strong Christian, read the Bible. Yes. And don't forsake it. Mm-hmm. And obey it. Because that's what Jesus said to the disciples, seven of them. This was the third time Jesus appeared to the disciples in Galilee. And it's interesting, after he'd given them some breakfast, and after they had a wonderful catch of fish, thanks to his direction, and please note that after Jesus died and rose again, the disciples needed to catch up with themselves. It was a huge experience to 1 minute to see him die on a cross. Remember, his mother watched him die.
Yes.
Remember that, how desperate she must have felt. But you see, it wasn't the end. 3 days later, the tomb was empty and he appeared, and he said, I want you to go into Galilee and I'll meet with you there. And so he got into Galilee, and the disciples, seven of them at least, I don't suppose Matthew the tax collector was interested in going fishing, but the rest were. And where the others disappeared to, I don't know. The Bible doesn't tell us. But I do know this, that God met with those seven in a wonderful way. And after he'd given breakfast, he said to Peter, he didn't start and say, Peter, why didn't you keep your word? You were never going to deny me, were you? He didn't say that. He wouldn't do that, wouldn't Jesus? He said, Peter, do you love me? Just think of a man saying to another man, do you love me? We can say that to Jesus. I hope no man here would ever be unwilling to say to Jesus, I love you, Lord. I love you with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength. Jesus transcends for men and women. He's the object of our heart's devotion. We love him. And he said to Peter, do you really love me? Yes, said Peter, I do. And then, you see, this is the clue of it. Jesus wants us to be followers of him and to work for him, not simply to have our names written in heaven. Yes, we can rejoice over the fact that they are written in heaven. That's how solid our foundation is as faith in Christ. But it's to serve him. And Jesus said, I want you to feed my lambs. Now that can mean for children. It can also mean for young converts. If you're a new Christian, you need support. You need to feed on the word of God. You need to hear what he has to say, because it's an ongoing life. You don't just start and that's it. No, it's the beginning of a glorious life of service, and it's costly at times, but it's so real. All these experiences deepen our faith and trust in him. We may not be able to answer all the questions that are fired at us, but in our hearts we know that we've passed from death to life, from the power of Satan to God. We know that we have a Saviour within us who is greater than all the things that are against us. If God be for us, who can be against us? So you see, here is Jesus saying to Peter a second time, do you really love me? He really does want to get this message over to Peter. And Peter said, well, you know I love you. Well, he said, then feed my sheep. Look after them. He didn't say feed them. Look after my sheep. Now, that's a task and a half. Every pastor knows. I'll tell you this, what it is to look after sheep, because sheep wander. You and I are often compared to sheep. All we like sheep have gone astray. We've turned everyone to his own way. But the Lord has looked after us and brought us to himself. Why do we do all this? Because we love Jesus. That's why we serve him. We don't come here to, it's not a paid position. Well, we have to pay to keep our pastor and his wife alive, but it's not, we're not in the business of receiving money, because we love Christ. Yes, we need to live, and we need to make sure that each other is cared for. We need to have a love for them, just as Jesus has a love for us and we have a love for him. So as we go into the work, it's a privilege. No, there's some people, I could tell you, I won't name anybody, but people will say to me, look, if you want me at 10 o'clock at night, I'll come to see you. I will. And they mean it. They mean it. And I want you to understand that Christian brothers and sisters should be dependable. Not say one thing and do another and take it easy. Because Jesus had nowhere to lay his head at times. So no wonder the refugees in the Ukraine and Israel and will feel some comfort from Christ, because they know he's been there before and he understands what people are going through. And we need to listen to what people are saying to us. Don't imagine that you know the answer to another person before you've heard what they have to say. We go and sit with them, and sometimes we weep with them. That's what Jesus did at the tomb of Lazarus, when the two sisters were mortified because he hadn't arrived in time, they thought, but he had a plan that was greater than their idea. And so they came to Jesus and he met their need and he wept at the tomb. There's nothing to be ashamed about weeping. Some of you would do the world of good if you let go instead of tightening yourself up. It's not that we a sign of weakness, it's a sign of real feeling. We can enter into what somebody else is going through. And the process of feeding the sheep and looking after the sheep is really a process that gives a lot of delight. Do you know, there's nothing better than to see people who have been converted progress, where they grow stronger and they are not afraid to get stuck into working for Jesus. I've spent my life, ever since I trusted Jesus at the age of 10, serving Jesus. He's a great master, absolutely wonderful. I don't understand all his ways because I'm not God. I'm just one of his most unworthy servants. But I love him, and that's why I can do some feeding of the sheep and looking after them, because I love Jesus. That's the real source. And Jesus is wanting the disciples to understand that if we truly love him, we'll be able to do all these things, but without that love, there's nothing worse. There's nothing worse than coming to church just because you think it's a habit. And you think, what's going to be different today? No, you come expecting, and we pray that God will bless us in a way that we have never realized before. And that's important. And so the last time he said to Peter, this is still in the 40 days, remember? He said to Peter, do you love me? For the third time, and Peter said, Lord, he was hurt. And I'm sure Jesus wanted him to feel hurt because he wanted to get that message home that everything we do should be out of love. That's why we serve. We stand in the doorway to greet people. Do you know that you'd be amazed at the number of cards that have reached me in these last few days concerning Doreen standing at the door, shaking hands with people. I was at one side of the door, she was at the other. You'd be amazed how many people all these years later have remembered what she said. And it's been quite remarkable. So please don't dismiss anything. It's very important that we have relationships in churches where we break down barriers between ourselves. And all because we love Jesus. That's the motive. It's not because we love people. Some people are very unlovable. But so are we. We've got corners, you know, that need knocking off. And this is the whole development of Christian living throughout, since our conversion, right to the day we walk into heaven. And remember, he's going to be there waiting for us. And he's going to, if you go through the waters, they will not overflow you. Though you go through the fire, you'll not be burnt. Because he's with us. This is the marvelous thing. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. Isn't that amazing? Nothing. Things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor anything in all creation can be able to separate us from the love of God. This is, we've got something wonderful, and we've got to pass it on. And Jesus said, you're not going to deny me, Peter. If you love me, I'll tell you that. And it's a fact, you know, there was a man, I can't remember, he was in his 80s in church history. I can't remember his name. Some of you might remember, but he was in his 80s and he was asked to deny Christ or be put to death. He said, I've loved Jesus all my life. How can I possibly deny him? If you're going to shoot me, shoot me. I'm going to stick with somebody I know. And that's what it is all about. So you might say, nobody's going to shift some of us, you know, because we love Jesus. That's the heart of it. And he wants us to recognize that, because his love is greater than our love for him. Yes. We love him because he first loved us. See the quality of love. And so you can see that. Oh, what a sad story about Judas Iscariot, isn't it? What a sad story to think that the Bible should come out with such detail as I read to you this morning. But I want you to understand that if people turn away from God, and if you are in ever in danger of turning away from him because the heat is on you, please remember that some people have gone to their death. Even in Britain, yes. In times past, for obedience to Jesus Christ. And we shouldn't think about it. We don't have a martyr complex. Of course we don't. We don't suddenly think, oh dear, you know. Just get on with it. What happens? He will understand. And he will be with us. So that's the great thing about it. You say, I don't know how I would cope. You don't have to think ahead how you're going to cope. Think about today. Live one step at a time. Trust Jesus for everything, literally everything. If you've forgotten something, you know, this morning, Lord, where did I put this? And, you know, I tend to ask the Lord about all sorts of things. And I tell you, get into the habit of doing it. Cultivate it. You know, you've got a timer on the oven, but just use your mind and say to the Lord, you know, I don't want it overdone. I don't want it underdone. All sorts of things. Talk to Christ about it. And then when it's for real and you really have to say something serious to people, you'll discover that all those little experiences have made you a more human person, a more likable person, somebody who can draw near to you and you're not afraid of them because you sense the love in their hearts. That's what we want to be like. And that's what Pentecost next Sunday really brought about. The coming of Christ has been brought about by his willingness to come to earth, to die, to be raised, to ascend, to sit at God's right hand, then to send his Spirit into our hearts. Wonderful. Praise you, Jesus. I love you with all my heart. I do love you. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I do ask you to help us genuinely, all of us, to have such a love for you that Peter in the end got there as well. In his own strength, he failed. In his own strength, in their own strength, the fishermen couldn't catch a single tiddler. But there were 153 by the time they'd listened to what Jesus said about fishing. And we want to listen to you, Jesus, about what we do in the home, in the garden, in the business world, in all the things that are legal and heavy, all the things that are light, like the songs of Europe, and without all these things that have turned music into something miserable. Oh, Jesus. Keep us light in spirit, whatever we may go through. We ask this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. The last hymn, please. In Christ alone, my hope is found. We'll stand to sing.
Jesus died, the wrath of God was seen.
touch with them. Yes. If they're not well, don't let anybody be missing and forget about them, please. Yes. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all.